bless that you would come. Holy Spirit, come. We come as those who are thirsty, thirsty for you, for your Spirit to fill us up. We certainly pray, Lord, that you would give us fresh eyes, mindful that this is a text that we're pretty familiar with if we've been walking with you for any amount of time. Pray for fresh eyes, that you give our hearts and souls and everything about us fresh insight. Whether that be through my words or in spite of my words, may it be so. Come, Lord Jesus. And all your people say, amen. So, before I really unpack the text, I want to propose to you that an encounter with Christ can be intimidating, mystifying, revealing, cleansing, refreshing, empowering, clarifying, and perhaps most of all, life-giving. I'm going to leave that up there for a second for you to think about it. I know some of you are note takers. You might want to write some of those words down. Last week was all about wrestling. This week's sermon's going to have a lot different feel to it, but it's no less about wrestling. I'm going to use kind of a synonym, actually, with wrestling, and that's wondering. I'm going to wonder a little bit about this text and what it means. So we're going to wonder. I wonder if you'll wonder with me as we wander our way through this text. So, Jesus and his disciples are headed north from Judea to Galilee, and they can go around but decide not to go around Samaria. Samaria. Why might they go around? Because the Jews have a long-standing beef with the Samaritans. When the Jews returned from the Babylonian exile, they found this group of people in the central part of what they considered to be their land. And these people made rival claims about being descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they made rival claims about where the center of the worship should be. And they thought that the Jews claiming Jerusalem was a heretical thought. So there was much ado between the Jews and the Samaritans. So they're coming through this land, and they come to Sychar, and the disciples go off to find something to eat. Jesus decides to sits down by Jacob's well. It says it's about the sixth hour, or about noon, the middle of the day. And while he's there, a woman walks up. Jesus asks for a drink. And that might not seem particularly odd, just one person asking another person for a drink. But if we get in touch with how odd this would have been to those of them back then I think we'll get at the heart of what this passage is about. So first of all, men in those days would have associated very little with any women outside of their family members. And in particular, devout holy men would have made sure that they weren't seen alone with another woman. So before there was the Billy Graham rule and the Mike Pence rule, there was the ancient holy man rule. And here he is interacting with this woman. He could be caught alone with this woman. And we know how startling it was, because when the disciples returned, John is sure to tell us that the disciples were surprised to find him talking with a woman. So she's a woman, and then beyond that, she's also a Samaritan woman. Samaritan woman, as I've just said, they have issues with one another, the Jews and the Samaritans. They didn't want to have anything to do with the Samaritans, and certainly didn't share drinks out of the same sort of drinking vessel or something like that. Yet here he is asking for a drink. And to make this triply strange, he's interacting with a woman from Samaria of ill repute. As many of you know, women would come to the well at the cooler hours of the day, probably early in the morning, maybe late in the afternoon, but probably early in the morning, certainly not at noon. And yet John is intentional to tell us that Jesus is sitting by the well at noon. This woman has come at the time when she is least likely to run into anybody. She doesn't want to rub shoulders with anyone from the town who knows her. As we come to find out, Jesus knows her and yet interacts with her anyway. A woman from Samaria of ill repute. Three strikes against her, and yet he interacts with her anyway. I wonder if there's a limit to how many strikes we can have against us before Jesus doesn't interact with us. What follows is some interesting banter between Christ and the woman, banter that's full of teasing and double meaning and misunderstanding. In the Gospels, we often find that people who encounter Christ misunderstand what he's saying. It gives me hope. I wonder if it gives you hope. Sometimes I misunderstand what he's saying. The misunderstanding in the gospel seems to arise from the fact that he's speaking on a heavenly level and they are listening on an earthly level. He's speaking on a heavenly level, they're listening on an earthly level. Indeed, I wonder how many times we encounter God only to mishear and misunderstand because our faith is worldly and we truly can't conceive a message from a whole other realm. One of the hardest things to do in this life is to conceive of the kingdom of heaven actually coming to earth. So it's only natural that these misunderstandings would take place. So when Jesus says, "You should actually be asking me for a drink," it's only natural that she thinks he was talking about ordinary water. You don't even have a bucket. And what? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob? His response then makes it clear that he's talking about something altogether different, something for which all the water on earth is merely a signpost, something for which all the water on earth is merely a signpost. Just as water quenches our physical thirst, the new life that he's offering, a life straight from the kingdom of heaven, will satisfy our deepest existential, immaterial soul thirst. In fact, it won't just quench that thirst, it will become like a well springing up within us, refreshing us with the same life that Jesus is now bringing into the world, a life from the kingdom of heaven into this world. Later, John will tell us that this living water is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. But for now, here in this passage, it's puzzling, it's confusing. And the woman, she's intrigued, she's interested, and yeah, she's confused. She says, I want this water that will grant me the earthly benefit of not having to keep coming back here to draw water. Give me this water that will be eternal. I don't want to come back here. And I wonder if someone should have told her, be careful what you ask for. Because here's the thing, she doesn't seem to realize that if you want to take up Jesus on his offer for living water, like a spring welling up within you, you'll have to dispense of that stale, stagnant, scummy water you've been living off up to that moment. Let me say that again. If you want to take Jesus up on his offer of living water, that living water that springs up like a well within you, you will have to dispense of that stale, stagnant, scummy water that you've been living off of up to that moment. Which is why the next line from Jesus is, go, call your husband, and come back. something about that still water. And we don't know all the particularities of her circumstance. Did each one of those previous marriages end because of the death of the husband, or did it end because of divorce, whether legal or informal? We don't know, but it seems clear that we can presume probably the latter. And was she equally sinned against as she was sinning? We don't know, but we can assume that her life consists of one emotional upheaval after the next. And perhaps there's this trauma in her life that makes it difficult for her to form lasting emotional connections. And regardless of what has happened, we know that her life is chaotic, that it's a mess. And we know that he knows that. There's no fooling Christ. And yet, I wonder how many times we, like her, think that we can fool Christ, and maybe even in the process, fool ourselves. Her reaction to his confrontation of her life is a classic example of what every pastor has experienced. All I have to do is name certain topics, or sometimes merely just show up in the room, and people will start to equivocate. Anything to distract from the present personal moment about their relationship with God. And often this leads the person to name whatever it is they can name about something religious. Yeah, I used to go to that church down in 8th Street. Then it was this: our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. And Jesus doesn't really take the bait to lighten the load or to take the focus off her. Instead, he uses what she says to call her further along. He says, yeah, you know that your holy mountain, our holy mountain controversy? None of that's going to matter, because all of that has changed. It has now changed. Now that he was bringing heaven to birth on earth, holy mountains no longer mattered. The true and living God isn't contained geographically or architecturally. Heaven cannot hold him, let alone a mountain or a temple. God is spirit, not the kind of spirit that abhors the physical world. He wouldn't have been incarnate if he did. Kind of spirit that transcends it. And the call to true worship that worships him in spirit is the call to look beyond any sort of man-made earthly idols and to see this spirit that transcends all. She's a little unsure what to make of that. So she says, well, when the Messiah comes, he'll explain everything to us. To which he says, I, the one speaking to you, I am he, which is this powerful equivalent to the great I am, the Old Testament. I am he. Just then, the disciples return, surprised that Jesus is talking with a woman, and they thought a lot of things that they didn't say. They thought a lot of things that they didn't say, which was probably for the best. She, for her part, drops her bucket and runs off. And just an hour ago or less, she was trapped in a life of immorality and lived as a social outcast. She went to the well at the time of day when nobody would be there to help fuel her shame. And now, an hour later, through this encounter with Christ, she has become the first mass evangelist. A woman. A Samaritan woman of ill repute becomes the first mass evangelist, even before Peter at Pentecost. And you know, it's not an uncommon theme in the Bible. God has this persistent, if not provocative, tendency to use the most unlikely of characters. And I wonder if you yourself are one of those unlikely characters. And if not, I wonder how many of you would care to admit that you are more like one of the disciples, sneering at those whose lives Jesus might be transforming, sneering at Jesus himself, indulging in that stale, stagnant, scummy water within, caught in disbelief as Christ describes how he's not hungry because he has food to eat that they know nothing about which they too, like the woman, misunderstand what he's saying. Because he's speaking on a heavenly level and they're listening on an earthly level. Indeed, I wonder how many times we encounter God only to mishear and misunderstand because our faith is worldly and we can't truly conceive a message from another realm. The text says, many of the Samaritans believed because of the woman's testimony. We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world. I wonder how many of the disciples said pretty much the very same. We didn't realize the level of our unbelief. Now we have seen for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world. So, what about this encounter with Christ? I think that it's intimidating. It's mysterious and mystifying. It's revealing and yet cleansing and refreshing and empowering and clarifying and, best of all, life-giving. And in the context of this sermon series, I wonder if that's what worship ought to be like. If that's what worship ought to feel like. I want to give you a moment to think about those words and relate them to our worship encounter with God. And I wonder if you know that these same words can be used to describe our experience of the Lord's table. That when we encounter Christ through the sacrament he gave us, it too can be intimidating and mystifying and revealing and cleansing and refreshing and empowering and clarifying and life-giving. I wonder if you've ever attached those words to the table. Some have been taught that it's only a remembrance of him. But the sacrament, this holy thing, that's why we call it a sacrament, it's sacred. This holy thing is more than a memorial. It is a present means of God's grace. It is a means by which God offers us himself. It is a place where we experience life in Christ and union with Christ. That's the greatest gift of an encounter with him, his very life. There's this document that we affirm in the Reformed tradition called the Belgic Confession. It was written in 1561. 1561, during this time of the Spanish Inquisition, as a way of clarifying the Reformed faith and the Reformed tradition, what these new Reformed believers believed. And Article 35 addresses the Lord's Supper, and it's tied closely to what we've just talked about from John 4. So I want to read from the Belgic Confession to you. To support the physical, earthly life, God has prescribed for us an appropriate earthly and material bread, which is as common to all people as life itself. But to maintain the spiritual, heavenly life that belongs to believers, God has sent a living bread that came down from heaven, namely Jesus Christ, who nourishes and maintains the spiritual life of believers when eaten, that is, when appropriated and received spiritually by faith. He's talking about when we eat Jesus by faith. To represent to us this spiritual and heavenly bread, Christ has instituted an earthly and visible bread as the sacrament of his body and wine as the sacrament of his blood. He did this to testify to us that just as truly as we take hold of the sacrament in our hands and eat and drink it with our mouths, by which our life is then sustained, so truly we receive into our souls for our spiritual life the true body and true blood of Christ, our only Savior. So he's saying we really do ingest the body and blood of Christ. We receive these by faith, which is the hand and mouth of our souls. We receive these by faith, which is the hand and mouth of our souls. We do not go wrong when we say that what is eaten is Christ's own natural body and what is drunk is his own blood. And this is where he clarifies it from the traditional transubstantiation Catholic belief up to that point. But the manner in which we eat it is not by the mouth, but by the Spirit through faith. This banquet is a spiritual table at which Christ communicates himself to us with all his benefits. At the table, he makes us enjoy himself as he nourishes, strengthens, and comforts our poor, desolate souls by the eating of his flesh and relieves and renews them by the drinking of his blood. So do you get that? That we do not believe that this is merely a memorial. We believe that through this sacrament we encounter Christ through his Spirit, and in turn he nourishes our spirit. A lot of people find that hard to believe, find that to be kind of a Catholic-y kind of belief, that Christ is actually present in this meal and that we have union with him. How could that even be possible when he has died, risen, and then ascended to the right hand of the Father? We affirm that he's seated at the right hand of the Father. How can he actually be present in this meal? And as I've quoted before, I think John Calvin has the best thing to say about this. Even though it seems unbelievable that Christ's flesh, separated from us by such a great distance, penetrates to us so that it becomes our food, let us remember how far the secret power of the Holy Spirit towers above all our senses, and how foolish it is to wish to measure his immeasurableness by our measure. How foolish it is to wish to measure our immeasurableness by his measure, by our measure. What then our mind does not comprehend, let faith conceive, that the Spirit truly unites things separated by space. So how do we consume him by Spirit? By the Holy Spirit. God is Spirit, and to worship him in spirit and in truth is to receive him as here living water for our souls. That is why we partake of it often. Often. We receive Christ here, and all who receive him will never be thirsty. The life he gives will become a well springing up to eternal life. That is what, that's why we come to this table so often. We talked this past week as elders about the possibility of maybe having communion every week. Talked about that a lot since I showed up. We decided that for now it'll be every other week, and that once we have a chance to really teach about it, even in a more concrete way, that a whole set of sermons that are just like this that lead us to the table, then we'll try it out every week as a little experiment. But that won't be until after Easter 2021, and hopefully maybe we can get more people together at that time. Maybe, please Lord. And in the meantime, we'll celebrate every other week. And part of the reason we will is because this meal nourishes us, strengthens us, comforts us. This is a living bread, and this juice is like the living water that wells up within us. It is a way in which we commune not only with each other, but with Christ himself. So, this is the way that Jesus said it when he originally instituted it. He was with his disciples, and while they were eating, he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. This do as often as you eat of it in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sins of many. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, the bread which we break is the communion of the body of Christ, and the cup which we bless is the communion of the blood of Christ. So all things are now.